One of them did immense damage to a number of dwellings in the locality. It almost virtually destroyed three houses. Didn't demolish them, but it, you know, completely wrecked them inside. Because the power, the force of the water smashed the windows and it just ruined everything. It had to be replastered and, you know, had a few floors down and everything. And then it flooded the rest of the street, where my daughter lived actually, to a depth of 2 feet. Now, they weren't going to give any compensation to anybody. They said we should have insurance. So we got involved and we managed to get them to provide some cover compensation to the people who had their homes severely damaged. They wanted to keep it confidential as much as they get out, you know, because obviously we didn't want people to, you know, complain about their snowball effects as it were, but obviously we were telling people we couldn't give the detail, obviously how much they were, but the same was compensation here. We then discovered that for everybody else who had their homes flooded to a depth of 2 foot, they were offering them £100 off the water. And the woman who runs, the chief executive, when I went to the meet her, she's struggling because she's only on £2.5 million a year. Mm. You know, you can't think, what in God's name is the kind of process here? You know, it's just so wrong and immoral, in my opinion. And we could sweep that away as a stroke. Yeah. But you know, the sort of model that we are talking about putting in place is very different to the kind of top-down statist approach that we put in place when we came to power in 1945. And I often talk about we need to rediscover the spirit of 1945. Ken Loach did a brilliant film, didn't he, about the spirit of 1945. My mum and dad's generation, all that generation coming back from the war, who said we ain't going to go back to the indignity of the means test and living in poor quality accommodation and being fearful about getting injured at work or falling ill because we couldn't afford the medical fees. We want something better. We heard all the nonsense after the end of the First World War about homes fit for heroes. It never happened. We ain't going to let that happen again. And even though everybody was saying at the time, all the pundits, like they were saying Jeremy's toast and the Tories are going to walk in, and they were saying, obviously in a less kind of febrile way than they were in the last election, because it was a little bit more like he wasn't in 1945, but everybody expected Winston Churchill to win the election. The great war leader. Great war hero, even though if you look at his history, as we all know, he was no friend of the working class. And obviously, you know, he just did that, didn't he? I mean, with this landslide Labour victory, and, you know, I think we can achieve that again. But I think the key to our success is reaching out, and so I never use phrase like reaching out, but I do think it is one which is relevant here, to those people who don't vote, who didn't vote at the last election, who didn't vote in 2015 and previously. Now, a lot of people talk about the fact that, you know, New Labour, we did some great things, let's be honest, I mean, you know, satisfaction in the NHS is never been high when we left office. I'm not one of those who says everything we did when we were in government last time in 30 years was terrible, but we did miss a trick. We did miss an opportunity to transform our economy, to transform our society, to our society, the majority that we had, to really change the balance of power in our country. And, you know, we squandered, I think, that opportunity. But what I think so many people, and the people in here, all of you remember, obviously, later going to power in 1997, and the great hope that we all had. And me, naively, I expect a lot of people thought, well, here we Blair's talk about the New Labour nonsense, but, you know, once we get in there, we'll see a bit of socialism, a bit of socialism anyway, a little bit. And of course, you know, if you remember, we made that infamous speech on the death steps of number 10, saying we campaign as New Labour and we'll govern as New Labour. Well, really, it was kind of, we'll accept Thatcherism and we will knock the rubber edges off it. Mm-hmm. And we did, to be fair, we did do that. We put money into public services and we did some different things, a minimum wage, offered it up, you know, short staff, etc. But having been a local government leader at the time, God is saying, we were talking about this outside, you know, whilst there was money available, it wasn't anywhere near sufficient, I don't think, and it wasn't resilient either, because when the Tories came in, they decimated local government from day one almost. You know, they had a special budget, emergency budget, and one of the first things is that they, I don't know if you benefit from here, but area-based grants, is when it's a stroke. You know, it was such an obvious lot of that. Mm-hmm. When Thatcher came in 1979, it was so much more difficult for her to, I mean, they came in with a pledge to, you know, the underwent, what, a small state, bought into the whole neoliberal nonsense. You know, if you dance with the likes of Friedrich I have to build freezer, etc. But it took them years and years to actually make the changes they want to do in the course that they eventually thought about. And I know, I'm a beneficiary of that. I mean, I school at 15, with no qualifications, and went to the factory for a bit, then I trained to bricklayer. I can't believe these hands used to like Britain, but they did, they're nice and soft now, but I did use them. I had to train them, not in fancy to go. Eventually, I got a job as a special under the Special Temporary Employment Programme.